next speaker, Professor Zhi Qing Lin from U.S. And we will hear about biofortification technologies. Please, Professor.
Thank you, Chair. Good afternoon. Thank you for being here. It's late. I'm going to talk about a kind of new strategy to develop a sustainable agriculture production system. We have several talks in this at this conference. We'll talk about element deficiency or water deficiency or different agriculture production system. Certainly, this kind of micronutrient malnutrition problem has been a significant issue in the world, and that can affect over 2 million people, from different reasons at a different level of deficiencies. And especially when we're talking about women and children, that's probably more significant. And we have talked about the effects of global warming, climate change, especially when we talk about the increasing CO2 emission into the atmosphere. Now we have studies found the elevated CO2 concentrated in the atmosphere can lead to some kind of micronutrient element deficiency. And a recent study has also showed, actually just published in August 2nd, research done by a group at Harvard University, they also found that this kind of increasing CO2 emission can lead to the protein deficiency. And if we look at another recent study that shows the effects of global climate change on selenium content in soil, and they have shown that increase or decrease of soil selenium content in different parts of the world. And talking about selenium, and certainly this will be my topic, my focus of this talk. And this year is the 200th anniversary of selenium was named or discovery. And we have the next week a sample about 350 selenium researchers can get together to celebrate that important event. And selenium is a naturally occurring trace element, and it's essential for essential to animals and humans, but not for plants in general. And it has a very narrow margin between nutritional required and toxic concentration. So a little bit more, then you have selenium toxicity, and then a little bit less, you have a deficient issue, and then like the very famous Kassan disease. Now, if we look at the right amount for human assumption, or in other words, recommended dietary daily intake, we are talking about something like 55 microgram per day. Now, selenium is important, it's essential nutrient element because it can form selenium proteins. And those selenium proteins are many of them very important enzymes. And at least 25 selenium protein has been identified, and almost half of them have been very well studied. Selenium protein research has been a very important topic in selenium research these days. And for example, the first group of selenium proteins, they are called the antioxidant enzymes. And this kind of glutathione peroxidase, they play a very important role in human health. So selenium and human health. Now we have to talk about selenium effects on human cancer. Back to 1983, the group of American scientists started a clinical trial to study the effect of selenium on cancer prevention or chemo prevention effect. And after 13 years of study, and they have reported selenium supplement supplementation that uses lignin enriched yeast can have a significant effect on the prostate cancer. The reduction rate is almost 60%. And then because of that, because of this very successful good story of the NPC program or trial, and in 2001, the National Cancer Institute of the NIH, they have started a new program with a much larger size of a sample of our volunteers, 35,000 patients of volunteers involved. But the different things is, this NPC trial uses selenium-enriched yeast, but this we call select project or program, they use selenomethionine, chemical compound, along with vitamin E. And after 50 years of a study, they have terminated the program, the project, and then they have found some side or negative effects. Bottom line is, from this selective program, is selenium did not show significant reduction for the prostate cancer. So certainly there's a controversy between the NPC and the select. Now, what is the reason for those differences or responsible for those controversial results? This is some preliminary explanation that has been published on the National Cancer Institute website. So I'm not going to repeat those. So bottom line is, I don't care, at least I don't care which one is correct. I think this is an ongoing research project, which is a topic. But one thing I want to emphasize is, you don't have enough selenium, you do have healthy, selenium deficient related to healthy issues. And one way to maintain the right amount of, required amount of selenium intake, daily intake, is to use a food supplement. You know, if you can see the number of the selenium content is 200 microgram, that's the one pill. That is the amount of dose that's used for the NPC or select and also select programs. One thing that you probably, some of you probably would not like to take a pill every day as a food supplement. You probably want to take enough selenium as you need it, as required, through normal dietary resources. That's a hit to the topic that I'm going to talk about, is a biofortification strategy. Now, the definition of a biofortification is defined as to find a way to increase the bioavailable content of essential nutrients, such as selenium, in those edible portion of plants or crop. Okay, this can be done through some kind of a special fertilizer or breeding process or other agronomic practices. Now, certainly advantages of using or that or applying this kind of concept is biofortification certainly can provide food that has a special higher nutrition value, we call functional food. And also that's cheaper, especially that's good for people, population in developing countries. Now, look at talking about selenium biofortification program. We're in the right place. That's selenium, soil selenium distribution in Europe. And we are somewhere here, right? So now, selenium biofortification program in Finland started in 1984. And the application of a fertilizer started in 1985. Okay? So they use sodium selenate to manage the fertilizer and then use that selenium enriched fertilizer for agriculture for crop production. Now, this initial rate, selenium treatment rate, is a 16 ppm, that's in 1985. That reduced to 6 ppm in 1990 because they have seen the changes, the dietary intake of selenium has been increased. And then they reduced it to 6 ppm, and later on they found that's not enough. So the current selenium amendment rate is 10 ppm. That started in 1998. So from the selenium biofortification program, the selenium content change in the different environmental, like fertilizer, soil, and crop tissues, and also human blood samples has been changed significantly. For example, 2 years after the fertilizer, selenium-enriched fertilizer application, the concentration of selenium in spring cereal increased by 15 times. And that's also the daily dietary selenium intake has increased from 40 micrograms, that's in 1985, 1 year after, and then to 80 to 124 micrograms, that is the highest peak in 1989. And then if you look at the human blood selenium concentration, has been increased by 70%. So the bottom line, the selenium biofortification program in Finland is a very successful, effective, it's a good story. Now, in addition to Finland, many other countries they have also have selenium deficiency issues. They have developed different kinds of selenium biofortification programs. This is something happens or has been done in China. And also they have feed crab and with the selenium amended or treated or supplemented food, and the crab can grow better and the size larger and healthier. And one crab can provide almost 50 microgram selenium, almost one daily uptake of intake dose. And then they also have other selenium-enriched products. And back to the United States, so this is the soy selenium concentration or distribution in the United States. And you can see some selenium in the soil has a distribution, has a lot of hot spots. Okay? It's not evenly distributed in soil. And how much do we have as an ordinary American, not to have a, you know, just beer or chips? If you have normal diet, you can have roughly about 120, 130 micrograms per day. Now, majority of selenium intake is from cereal. Okay, and of course, depending on where you are, because of selenium distribution, soil selenium distribution has a lot of hot spots. So, for example, if the wheat produced in North Dakota, you can have 10 ppm, but in Kansas area, it's only 0.5. Now, if you talk about the state, now U.S. beef is 0.81 ppm, then the beef can provide almost three times more, okay? Now, if we look at another place in Central California, and this is a very highly productive agricultural area, and if you look at the Central Valley of California, on the western side, this part of the valley, selenium, soil selenium are high, and this part of the valley, selenium, soil selenium can relatively low. So farmers have to use selenium as supplement for their livestock. Okay? Now, in that area, from the western part of the valley, you know, broccoli or canola oil or some other agricultural product usually has higher content or concentration of selenium. And also recent years, my collaboration at USDA, they have looked at cactus and raw cactus. The fruits enriched with selenium have been used for wine or juice, and also for cereal production. Okay? Now, also, we have looked at the honey produced in the area and from the elevated selenium concentration from that area. And if you have been in the Central Valley, you know this is a groundwater that was high and evapotranspiration was high too, especially in summer growing season, not much precipitation. The root zone has a lot of salt accumulated along with the selenium, boron, and the arsenic. Now, the farmer has to use fresh water, clean water to leach, to wash off those salts, and then those drainage water have been collected and discharged into this large evaporation pond. So water evaporated, salt collected, remained collected. Now, we have found a different way to manage this kind of selenium-contaminated drainage water issue. We try to develop phytomanagement system. In other words, we try to use different plant species. They have different levels of salt tolerance, and then try to develop an on-farm recycling drainage system. In other words, all water being recycling on-site, there's zero discharge. Now, with this kind of a phytomanagement system, and we certainly would have to deal with the plant material. So if we grow canola in the area, and the canola plant tissue will be collected, and then we use that as an animal feed, mixed with normal animal feed for cow in this area. Now, one day probably we can change the commercial knockdown milk. But also seeds of canola have been used for piece by piece production, and then the milk after the press, going press, can be used for animal feed for chicken, and then egg can contain more selenium compared with the control. Now, in this area, because of a high soil salinity, I also have found plants can grow there very well. Halophytic plant. One of the halophytic plant species is Salicornia bibulovae or pigweed. It can be also can grow there, and you can harvest as a vegetable or green vegetable. Now, the other different idea research question is: can we use those plant materials, selenium-rich plant material, to grow mushroom, edible mushroom? Selenium can be transferred from the plant material substrate into the full body of edible fungi. Now, before we do that, we did that experiment. We collect different mushroom species on the different area, different region of the United States, from the Midwest and also from Northern California. We purchased it. The mushroom, different mushrooms from different stores, which is produced by different producers. And what we found that these three mushrooms, white button, pot bella, baby bella, they have the highest selenium concentration in the fruit body. And it should have the oyster mushroom, a little bit much less, but a little bit better than some other not very common mushroom on the market. So if we look at those three, white button, the pot bella, baby bella, we found that they all belong to this species, Agaricus bisporus, and just three different varieties. Now, because of all this species is the secondary decomposer, so therefore, these plant material that used as a substrate has to be composed first. So we brought those plant material, we compost, and then we add some horse manure, then we grow those white cotton, baby bella, pork bella mushroom in the lab. And we have found that this species can accumulate more selenium in the tissue fruit bodies with increasing selenium concentration in the substrate. But if we use the material that we produce, we prepare, and that's what we call the biofortification treatment. And compare with the control. Control is a substrate used by fresh mushroom producer in the country. That we have found that the biofortification treatment. How many minutes?
2 minutes.
2 minutes. Okay.
Two questions.
Then. Sure. Thank you. Then we can see the nucleus of selenium concentration in the biofortified mushroom. And also we have look at the. Oyster mushroom, after 45 days, we can have a mushroom, oyster mushroom produced. And the concentration of selenium biofortified mushroom is much higher compared with the commercial produced mushroom. And this is the selenium concentration in the substrate. This is a speciation result. Speciation actually determine the chemical selenium chemical compound in the sample, and we have found that the majority of selenium is in the form of xenonomatani. The other ones we have a problem to extract all the selenium from the mushroom tissue. And then if we're talking about selenium speciation results or analysis, of course different crops has different dominant selenium compounds. For example, if we talk about wheat, xenonomatani is going to be the dominant chemical compound. Broccoli is going to be selenium methylselenium-16. That's the most effective selenium compound. If you want to look at the selenium compound, this is the one that you should look at. And probably broccoli is better. Now, selenium phosphorylation is a new strategy. That's a new strategy. Also can deal with some other toxic heavy metal problems. For example, selenium mercury can form a complex to reduce the mercury toxicity in fish, for example. And the arsenic also has been studied. And the selenium biofortification strategy, gets in the early stage. And hopefully, we can make it much better and more effective. Thank you.
We have exactly 2 minutes for discussion. Questions, please.
So, CQ, how are you? Are you redistributing these now to Kansas into the Midwest where it's low selenium? I mean, how are you using this to ameliorate the problems where there's low selenium?
I'm sorry.
How are you using this to ameliorate the problems where there's low selenium? The Midwest is low selenium, right?
The Midwest, that's also some areas not that low. The Midwest.
And others that are very low.
In some other areas, very low. Yeah. In the United States, the food distribution system is very well established. So it's not something, like isolated to village. You have that selenium deficiency or toxicity problem.
But if you actually need to ask how to ameliorate, would you recommend adding selenium to fertilizers as we go in Finland?
Yeah.
In Finland, yes, that's because that's a separate good story.
Yeah.
A very effective program. But in the US, I don't think, that's necessary. Because of food distribution, we have that North South Dakota area, this selenium enriched wheat has been separately collected and then sold to European countries. So that's called precision agriculture.
I see some other questions to be asked, but I'm sorry, but we have to go on. Thank you very much.